بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد. So the way that this book has been structured, very simple. What is تزكية? And after that, the first part of it is good characteristics, and the second part of it is the evil characteristics. The good characteristics, alhamdulillah, you know, we can read that on our own. It doesn't require a lot of difficult, you know, we can do that on our own. Good characteristics is something that we can do on our own. For example, physical fitness, a person is jogging every day. And this is something that, to a certain extent, a person can do it without a trainer, to a certain extent. Just even if you do push-ups and sit-ups at the house, right? You know, without having a, membership at 24-hour fitna, right? You can still do it at home. You don't need to have a membership. You can still, you know, do a certain amount of exercise and, you know, take a brisk walk around the park. And with that, you'll get some cardio, you get healthy, you lose weight. But when it comes to disease and sickness, that's something that a person can't conduct and do on his own. That's something which is difficult. That is why the evil character, inshallah, we're going to go right into it. And we're going to start with the cancer and Ummul Amrad. Shaykh al-Hadith, Mawlana Zakariya, rahimahullah, right, who was a great Shaykh al-Hadith. He wrote a book called Ummul Amrad, the mother of all diseases. And this second part on page 41. If we all go to page 41, we are starting with the mother of all diseases. This mother is really a mother. This is a mother. It gives birth to all the other evils. This mother is the one that gives birth to all the other evils. From kibr, which we mentioned, right, in the hadith of the Prophet in the first session, the Prophet ﷺ said that anyone who has a Adam's weight of kibr in their heart, and kibr comes from kabura, kibriya, greatness, exaltation. And my Shaykh rahimahullah in one of his risalas that he wrote, Ilaj-e Kibr, what a beautiful explanation about the hurma and the impermissibility of kibr he gives. He says, وَلَهُ الْكِبْرِيَاءُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَهُ الْكِبْرِيَاءُ. Look at this. It's تَقْدِيمُ مَا حَقَّهُ التَّأْخِيرُ يُفِيدُ الْحَصْرِ. It's supposed to be وَالْكِبْرِيَاءُ لَهُ, that exaltation belongs to him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought the lahu first, right? He brought this khabar muqaddam, mubtada muakhar. He brought the walahul kibriya'u fis sama, and to only to him belongs exaltation in the heavens and the earth. Only to Allah belongs. And taqdeemu ma haqqahu at-ta'khir yufidul hasr, to bring forth that which was meant to be later, right? Only to him belongs all greatness, right? Only greatness belongs to him. So this verse my Shaykh mentioned, it proves that in heavens and the earth, there is nobody that has a right to say that I am great except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the names of Allah is Al-Mutakabbir. Al-Mutakabbir, the one who is the most exalted, right? And now if we say to a person, hey, you're mutakabbir. If we say to a person, ye shakhs bahut mutakabbir aadmi hai. Is that a praise? Or is it a dispraise? It's a dispraise. You're actually blaming the person. This person is very mutakabbir. He's very prideful. But when you say for Allah, al-khaliq al-bari al-mutakabbiru. Allah is the mutakabbir because he's worthy. He is worthy of being proud. He is worthy of being exalted. He is worthy of being elevated. What is insan worthy of elevation? We have no worth to be elevated. Alam nakhluqkum min ma'in mahin? Did not I create you from a dirty drop of fluid? A despicable drop of fluid? Thumma ja'alnakum fi qararin makin? And then we put you in the womb of the mother. What were you? Khalaqakum min turabin. First you were dust. Thumma min nutfatin. Then you were a drop of sperm. ثُمَّ مِنْ عَلَقَةٍ. Then you are a clot of blood. Mudghatin. Then you are a chewed piece of flesh. Let me ask you guys a question about all of these four things that Allah says is our essence. First, turab. You like turab to be on top of your bed, on your pillow, on your shelf, on your books? You like turab? Does somebody have like a display in his house displaying turab? This is my collection of turab. This is my collection of dust and dirt and mitti. You like this mitti? This is my mitti collection. Your pagal collection, man. What are you talking about, mitti collection? Nobody collects mitti. Nobody collects dust. It's worthless. When it comes on your books and it comes on your house and you just want to, you know, dusting everything off, you don't want mitti to be everywhere. It's worthless. It's dirty. This is our first essence, turab. This is our first essence. Second essence, nutfa. A drop of dirty fluid. Does anybody display drop of dirty fluid? A'udhu billah, such a dirty thing that a person, you know, having it on his body, having it on his clothes, he quickly wants to go wash his clothes, he quickly wants to take a shower, that there's this dirty drop of fluid on my clothes or on my body. It's filth. Nobody displays such a filthy thing. This is the second essence of our creation. Then after that, alaqa, a clot of blood. Najis. Does anybody display clot of blood? This is my clot of blood collection. Clot of blood. You have blood on your clothes, you're going to quickly wash it off. Right? And if you have a t-shirt that has blood on it, you just throw it away because the stain is not coming off. It's dirty. It's something that is not good. Allah said your third essence is a clot of blood. This is you. This is us. This is insan. And then the fourth, mudgha. What are you? A chewed piece of flesh. You eat a kebab and you put it on display. You know, you eat a piece of kebab and you chew it and chew it and chew it and you can't swallow it, then you put it on the side. It looks sick. It looks gross. That's gross, right? Chewed piece of flesh. You take a piece of kebab and you chew it. Chew it and chew it and chew it until it's, right, nice and mashed up. Right? And then you just put it there. Is this something which is very attractive, very beautiful? It's worthless. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the essence of insan. Think about your essence. One of the mashayikh said, he said, when, right, you, a person claims that I am better than him and I am better than that and I am so superior and I am so great and do you know who I am and do you know what I've done and do you know what my accomplishments are and do you know what my achievements are? Do you know who I am? A person says that, so one of the mashayikh said, he said, you look at what you import and export on a daily basis. What are we? We import in the night and we export in the toilet in the morning. That's what we are. We're import and export machines. We're importing food in the night and we're exporting the food in the toilet in the evening. If you have any thought of yourself that I am a very great this and I am a very great that and this is my bank balance and this is my Mercedes and this is my house, okay, then look at inside your toilet what you export. That's who you are. That's what you carry. How can a person consider himself to be more superior and try to challenge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I apologize for being so frank and being so open about this, but this is a reality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that these are our essences that we should ponder over. Does man not ponder over what we created him from? So the cure for the sickness of regarding oneself as kibr. This illness is very dangerous. This is the cancer. This is the cancer of all diseases. It is the same sickness that caused shaitan to become rejected. He uses this prescription that he had tried on himself, on people with great ease, and finds it very useful in leading them astray. Shaitan was led astray by this. So shaitan himself also uses this to lead others astray. Shaitan knows he became mal'oon because of kibr. So he uses the same weapon against people to make them mal'oon as well. This sickness causes a son fight with his father, a student with his teacher, a murid with his sheikh, and a slave with Allah Most High. The son says, who do you think you are? You can't tell me what to do. But I'm your father. I don't care. I've grown up now. You know how old I am? 12 and a half. And a half. Right? You know, when we're at that age, we're like, and a half. That and a half, it's a lot. You can't, you know, I was with my son. And somebody was asking, so how old are you? So I answered, I said, he's 7. He said, no, I'm 7 and a half. I said, okay, 7 and a half. Right? makes you proud, pride. Even it makes you fight with your own father when you're proud. And it'll make a student fight with his own teacher. And it'll make a murid fight with his own sheikh. And a slave fight with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the first to be rejected in the divine court, shaitan, was destroyed because of the sickness. Shaitan was the first one. For this reason, the pious and righteous elders tell their friends and servants to be extremely cautious of it. Become extremely cautious. Due to this sickness, a person regards himself to be greater and superior to others in knowledge, worship, piety, wealth, honor, intellect, or any other matter. He regards others as lowly and despicable. Such a person is despised by others in this world, even though they may praise him in his presence due to fear or greed. Certain people that are prideful, right? Like a tyrant king or Fir'aun or any type of people like that, they're very prideful. You're afraid of them. You respect them in their face, but you actually hate them. We don't like people that think like they're all bad, right? People that think they're all, you know, hotshot. Nobody likes them. When you see that a person is humble and you see that a person is, everybody is attracted to a humble person. And everybody hates a proud person, isn't it? It's just natural. You don't want to show respect because he thinks that everybody should respect him. But he has not earned the respect of people. A respect and honor is something that's supposed to be earned. It's not something that's supposed to be demanded. And mutakabbir and proud people, they demand respect. But nobody really respects them. People are afraid of them. Oh my God, he's gonna, you know, beat me up. Like a bully. A bully is a perfect example of a mutakabbir person. He wants you to respect him. He doesn't earn respect. That's a bully. But kind people, humble people, you look at them, oh, what a humble person. You automatically just feel attracted to that person. So even though they might praise this person in his presence due to fear or greed, such a person does not accept anyone's advice. Who are you to tell me? Do you know who I am? Nobody. Such a person does not accept the advice of anyone. Rather, he fights with those who advise him. Don't tell me what to do. I know everything already. Right? And he does not accept the truth when someone tells him. If somebody tells you the truth, right? These are the two signs of kibir. Ghamtun nas, to look down upon people. Wa batarul haq, right? To reject the truth when somebody tells you. Somebody tells you, you're wrong. No, I'm not wrong. I'm right. Who are you to tell me that I'm wrong? Do you know who I am? I'm so-and-so. So what's holding him back from accepting the truth? His own pride. The reality of kibr has been referred to in a hadith, rejecting the truth and looking down upon people, just as we mentioned. Whoever finds these two signs within himself should immediately seek a cure for his illness, or else there is fear that all of his good deeds may be reduced to dust. A hadith states, whoever has in his heart a mustard seed's worth of arrogance will not attain even the fragrance of Jannah, never mind Jannah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever humbles and lowers himself for Allah, Allah will grant him honor and status among people, even though he regards himself as lowly. He who lives with arrogance, then Allah will disgrace him until he will be regarded as more despicable than a dog or a pig in the eyes of people, even though he regards himself as very great in his heart. Hakimul Ummah Tanwi, may Allah have mercy, has recorded this hadith in his book, Khutubatul Ahkam. Right? Man tawadha'a lillahi rafa'ahu Allah. Anyone who humbles himself for the sake of Allah, Allah elevates him. How many people like to be elevated? We all like respect. This is a reality. Imam Al-Ghazali mentions this is the nature of insan. Nobody wants to be disrespected, and that's your right. Everybody should be respected. This is not something which is wrong. But the way to attain it, that's the question here. How do you attain elevation? True elevation. How do you attain that? Here Allah Azza wa Jal, through the Messenger of Allah, has taught us that مَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهِ رِفْعَةً will be granted, yes. But the one who humbles himself. Anyone who humbles himself, Allah will elevate him. You want elevation? No, nothing wrong with that. But the Prophet told you how to attain it. Lower yourself and Allah will elevate you. Humble yourself and Allah will elevate you. Right? I used to hear from my grandfather, Rahimahullah, pada kalana megov ke darakhte ke meva me dashte bashe o darakh payan kham me bashe. Right? That tree that has a lot of fruit, that tree is humbled. Right? The tree that has a lot of fruit, the tree starts hanging down. Have you seen the branches of a tree that has fruit? It goes like this, right? And a tree that doesn't have any fruit is like this. There's no fruit. It's sticking like no leaves. Have you seen like the trees, how the trees are in the winter or in the stiff, right? And the tree that has a lot of fruit in it, then it's very humble. It's very low. That's why the people who actually have something within their heart, they have this heaviness, they have this humbleness. But the people who have nothing and they're completely empty, khali, inside, right? They're always like this in front of people, right? And anyone who elevates himself in front of people, himself, without Allah elevating him, he wants to elevate himself by himself. Allah Ta'ala will then degrade him in the eyes of people. People will recognize this guy's showing off. People will recognize this guy's putting himself up. To such an extent that he will become so despicable, he'll be more despicable than a dog or a pig. You know why? Because a dog and a pig, you feel sorry for the thing. You know, it's an animal. Sometimes you might feel like a little poor dog, right? Dog doesn't have any. You might not allow it to come in the masjid or come inside the house, but you're like a poor dog. You see it and you just throw some piece of bread for it. Okay, that's the dog. It's just... But a person who's prideful, you have no remorse for that person. You don't have any feelings for that person. Because the guy is just a terrible person. He just is full of himself, right? If one does not despise anyone, now there's another level. So let's say you think yourself to be number one, but you don't look down upon anybody else. What about that? What about that? Like, I don't look down on people. I love everybody, but I'm the man, you know? You know, I got it. I'm the man. I'm educated. I'm smart. I'm beautiful. You know, I know I make heads turn when I drive. You know that love of the self, right? If one does not despise anyone, but only regards himself as being good, then he regards his accomplishments and good conditions to be his own perfection and not a gift from Allah. I did this and I did that and this is my book and this is my writing. Don't you see what I've done? Right? This is my book and this is my this and this is my that. Right? Not saying, Alhamdulillah, Allah granted me the ability to write this book. This was to the tawfiq of Allah. I would not have been able to do it without Allah. Alhamdulillah الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. This is a gift that was given to me by Allah. Otherwise, I would not have been able to do it. Allah gave me the ability. So a person, he thinks that he's the one who achieved everything. Thus, he does not fear the loss of changing of any bounty, whether it be knowledge, piety, steadfastness, spiritual exercises, worship, beauty, wealth, honor, or good character. This is referred to as ujub. Conceitedness. This is also evil. Brothers and sisters, look at how dangerous this is. My Shaykh rahmatullah alayhi used to say, he said, Nek guftan haram, Nek shudan wajib, Nek guftan manekastam, Mishara manekastam. I am a very, very pious person. To say this is haram. Because Allah said, La tuzakku anfusakum. Don't say that I'm a very good person. Huwa a'lamu biman ittaqa. Allah is the one that took you out of the wombs of your mothers. He's the one who knows who's more pious. Don't make tazkiyah of your own self. Don't say that I am this, that, and the other. This is referred to as ujub. Ujub means conceitedness. This is when you don't look down upon anybody, but you look very high esteem of yourself. Ibn Ata'illah al-Iskandari rahimahullah, the great Arif Billah, he says that the root of all evil is looking good at yourself. That's the root of all evil. Why is that the root of all evil? Remember, brothers and sisters, this is not talking about, right, self-confidence. If a person is self-confident, then I can give a good lecture. This is not ujub. A person is self-confident that he can lead prayer and recite the Quran very beautifully. This is not ujub. To be self-confident in something that Allah has granted you, this is not considered ujub. Self-confidence is not ujub. Self-conceitedness is ujub. And what is self-conceitedness? I am a very great person and I have no faults. I'm a good guy. Why is this something which is bad? Because then there's no room for criticism. Isn't it? If you're good, then there's no room for any bad there. And this is why Ibn Ata'illah said, he said, thinking yourself to be good is the root of all evil. And thinking yourself to be bad and imperfect, this is the root of all good. Thinking yourself to be imperfect, this is the root of all good, because you're going to continuously start working on yourself. That look, I'm weak. I need to gain more knowledge. We have shuyukh that are sitting here. Maulana Faisal is here. Sheikh Qasim is here. These are shuyukh. Why do they need to be sitting in my lecture? Allah has granted them knowledge. But this is a perfection, a goodness that Allah has granted in them, that I need to increase myself. I need to learn, because there's always room for improvement. One time, Maulana Abdul Hamid Sahab, Damat Barakatuhum, he was a principal of our madrasa where we studied first 2 years in South Africa, Azadville. He came to the Khanqa where my sheikh is, and I asked him, Hazrat, give me some advice. What a beautiful advice Maulana Abdul Hamid, Damat Barakatuhum, he gave. He said, look, when you take a ball and you throw it real high, or you bounce a ball and you throw it real high, he said, that point where it's the highest, the high point when it's the highest is the point when it starts coming down. The climax of the elevation of that ball is the moment of climax is actually the moment of descent. Anybody who did physics, right? What goes up must come down, right? Newton's law. But the climax point of a ball going up through, right, the force of the hitting the ball up and then it goes, the point of climax is actually the beginning point of descent. This is what the Shaykh told me. He said, remember that in your spirituality, never ever say that I have reached my climax. Ujub is that state where a person says, I have reached my tipping point. I don't need anymore. I am here now. This is where I am. I'm good. Like the ball, what does the ball say when it's at that point? I'm good. That's what the ball is saying. Right when it's at the top point, it's saying, I'm good. I don't need to go any higher. That is the moment where you start coming down. And that is what ujub is. That point where we say, I don't need to go any higher. I am perfectly fine where I am. Brother, I pray 5 times a day. Why are you telling me? Oh, subhanAllah, you pray 5 times a day. There was mashayikh that used to pray 300 rakats in a day. They used to pray 8-9 times a day, including tahajjud. Right? Brother, I've paid my zakat. What do you want from me? Ali radiallahu anhu, he gave so much sadaqah that zakat never became wajib on him. He never kept that much money with him. Every day he was giving sadaqah. That they say throughout the life of Ali ibn Abi Talib, zakat never became binding on him because he never had that money with him. The amount of nisab was never with him. Zakat never became binding upon him. These were the sadaqah. We should be aspiring to be greater. And in the matter of dunya, right, we always want more. We always want to do better. But in the matter of deen, we're very content with ourselves. I'm a very good person. I'm a very good person. I pray 5 times a day. I don't need any improvement. Right? I'm a good Muslim. I don't hurt anybody. I didn't rob a bank. You know, I don't commit adultery. I'm just a good person. I don't need to better myself. That's ujub. When a person says, I have a lot of, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me. Ya Allah, forgive me. Ya Allah, how can I better myself? Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant. Khalaqtani wa abduk. Wa ana ala ahdika wa ahdika. A'udhu bika min sharri ma sana. Oh Allah, forgive me what I've done. Oh Allah, forgive my sins. Oh Allah, I'm so weak. Considering your weakness, you will always have room for improvement. And considering your strengths will always make you think that you're perfect and you have no more room for improvement. And like that ball, right? When the ball has no more room to go higher, that is the moment of its descent. وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that above every knowledgeable person, there is one who is more knowledgeable. This is referred to as ujub. Hakim al-Ummah Tanwi rahimahullah said in Kamalat al-Ashrafiyya, when a servant becomes lowly and despised in his own sight, then he is good in the sight of Allah. And when he regards himself to be good, then he is evil in the sight of Allah. All of us want to be good in the sight of Allah, right? So you should consider yourself to be lowly to yourself. Consider yourself to be low to yourself. That moment when you consider yourself to be a sinner, I am a sinner. I have so many sins that I can't even count those sins. I don't know what Allah is going to do with me on the Day of Judgment. But I have hope in His mercy. I will not become hopeless of Allah's mercy. But I know my sins. I know who I am. This person, he will always be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says, Ya ayyuhan nas, tubu ila Allahi wastaghfiruhu, fa inni atubu fil yawmi mi'ata marra. What is left for us? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said that, O mankind, make tawbah to Allah and seek forgiveness of Allah. For indeed, I seek forgiveness from Allah 100 times a day. Do you know the Prophet used to seek forgiveness from Allah 100 times a day? And what did Allah say about him? غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Allah has forgiven your past and previous sins. Past and future sins, Allah has forgiven all of them. You don't have none. Despite that, the Prophet used to seek forgiveness from Allah 100 times a day. This is to teach his ummah. The cure for kibr and ujub. Now is the main thing. So everybody understood what is ujub and kibr. Now is the cure. And this is the beauty of this book. First, it tells you the symptoms, right? And then it gives you the cure. The cure for kibr and ujub, page 43. The cure for arrogance is to reflect over Allah's greatness and to think of one's final result. By saying, for example, I do not know how my death will be. Subhanallah. Just everybody listen. We're going to explain that. Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, he was actually of Persian descent. Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, Gailani. It was actually, it's not Jilani. It was Gailani. Gailani, the letter Jim is not in the Arabic language. So in Arabic, it became Jilani. But he was actually Gailani. And he was from Ahl Bayt. And he was one of the greatest of the awliya and the mashayikh and the scholars of one of the greatest mashayikh of this ummah. So a woman came and started to praise Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. Oh Sheikh, you are the wali and you are the qutub. And he mentioned a poem in Farsi. And I learned this poem. This is one of the few Farsi poems of Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. Actually, when I was in Afghanistan, my father-in-law, he showed me the diwan of Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani in Farsi. It's very small, risal, like 10 pages. But he has ash'ar in Farsi as well. So this is one of his ash'ar. When this old woman came and said, oh Sheikh, you are this, that, and the other, and you're so great. So you know what Sheikh said? He said, Iman shu salamat bala be gor birim. Iman shu salamat bala be gor birim. Ahsantu barin chusti u chalaki ma. Iman shu salamat bala be gor birim. Ahsantu barin chusti u chalaki ma. He says, oh old woman, if I reach my grave with Iman and I die with faith, then I will say ahsantu to this cleverness of mine. What did he say? That you're praising me and you're saying that I'm a very great wali. But if I don't die with Iman, then all of my actions will be waste. And I don't know what my end will be. I don't know how my end will result. I don't know, will I die with Iman or will I die without Iman? I don't know. This is something that is unknown. Al-khatimatu masturatu. The end result is hidden. So we should always think to ourselves, I don't know how my death will be. Somebody just asked a question. What about looking down upon non-Muslims? For a Muslim, you're not even supposed to look down upon non-Muslims. Ah, this person is a kafir. These disbelievers. Infidel. Our mashayikh have taught us, do not even look down upon non-Muslims. Why? Because you don't know. Allah might give them iman and you might die on kufr. How do you know? Has there not been amongst us, mashallah, so many people that were not Muslim before? How many people that are in this gathering, they were not born Muslim? I'm talking about from a family perspective. If you were to have looked down upon that person who was a non-Muslim and said with despise, ah, this kafir, this disbeliever, he's despised, he's a low person. Imagine that after that person becomes Muslim, you are looking down upon a Muslim actually. You are looking down upon a Muslim. A true believer will never look down upon any human being because he knows, even if he's a non-Muslim, because he knows that there is hope that that person will become a mu'min. There is hope that that person will become a believer. To look down, imagine if the Prophet looked down upon the kuffar, how would he give them da'wah? Let me tell you, if you despise people, how can you call them to Allah? You have to love people. You have to have mercy for people. If you don't have love for our non-Muslim brothers and sisters that are out there, and wallahi, they are gold mines. The Prophet ﷺ said, "An-nasu ma'adin." كمعادن الذهب والفضة خيارهم في الجاهلية خيارهم في الإسلام إذا فقه. That mankind, all of mankind, Muslim and non-Muslim, they are gold mines of gold and silver. People, even non-Muslims that are out there, they have such sifat, such qualities. They have patience, they have love, they have compassion. There's people that are supporting Muslims, fighting for Muslim rights. There are people that are doing protests for Syria. There's people that are doing protests for Iraq and Afghanistan who are not Muslim. This is the goodness in their hearts. They're gold mines. And now you're looking down upon those people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is not from his teachings. An-nasu ma'adin. The Prophet taught us to look at all of people as they are mines, mines of gold and silver. People with potential. When the Prophet would look at a person, he wouldn't look at his skin color. He wouldn't look at his background. He wouldn't look at his faith. He wouldn't look at if he was Jew or Christian. He would look at the potential in that person. That this person has a potential to become a Muslim. This person has a potential to become better than me. And isn't it? There are so many converts to Islam that today they are better than us. The converts in our community are our teachers. The converts in our community, they're not our pets. Don't treat them that way. They're human beings and they're better than us. May Allah reward them. Why are they better than us? How can I say somebody's better? I have proof for that. يُؤْتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ يُؤْتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran that those who follow the previous religion of Judaism or Christianity and accept Islam, Allah gives them two lights. Allah gives them two mercies. The mercy of the previous religion that they were following a prophet and the mercy of the religion in the ummah of Muhammad. Are they not more? Everything is doubled. For a convert, everything is doubled. His salat is doubled. His fasting is doubled. His zakat is doubled. His hajj is doubled. Rejoice and don't look down upon anyone, especially a non-Muslim. So, we don't know what our end will be. It is possible that Allah Most Exalted dislikes some of action of ours to the extent that He throws out all of our other actions, such as pride. Pride can make all of our other actions become worthless. Moreover, it is possible that the person that we are looking down upon had once done such an action in his life that Allah Most Exalted loved, whereby all of his sins will be forgiven. Like we know the hadith in Bukhari, that Allah Ta'ala forgave a prostitute because she gave water to a dog that was thirsty. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala rejected a woman and threw her in hellfire because of a cat that she had tied up. And she did not let that cat eat from the creatures of the earth, and then it starved to death and it died. Look at the example. One woman was very pious, but because of that one action of dhulm that she did, Allah rejected all of her actions. And look at that prostitute who lived her life in sin. But because of the fact that she saved a dog who was dying of thirst, Allah Ta'ala accepted her and granted her Jannah and forgave her sins. So let's not judge. Let's not judge. We don't know who's who. Our pious and righteous elders, our mashayikh, have mentioned an incident that will greatly assist in cure of this sickness. The girls of a certain locality beautified one girl who was getting married. She looked very beautiful with her jewelry and attractive clothing. And her friends complimented her, saying, "Sister, you look gorgeous. When you go to your husband, he will really appreciate you." At this, the girl began to cry and said, "Oh, my friends and sisters, I am not overjoyed with your compliments and praises. When my husband sees me, likes me, and compliments me, only then will I be absolutely overjoyed." And what is the moral of the story? People can praise you all day and night. "Oh, Shaykh, you gave a wonderful lecture. Oh, that was really great. Oh, you look so pious. Oh, you're so nice." Yeah, you're saying it, but what does my Allah say? Just like that woman who, or that young girl who at her wedding night, she's beautified, but she doesn't know, is my husband going to think that I'm attractive or not? Is my husband going to select me? That is what matters. Where does the praise matter if Allah praises you? The praise of people mean nothing. Always remember that. The praise of people mean nothing if Allah does not praise you. This is a wonderful cure. Just think about this. When you, for example, a lot of people have a problem. "Oh, mashallah, this is so wonderful. And oh, what a great lecture." And you know, we're always affected by that. You know, we're always seeing. And then you feel like, "Oh, you know, I feel pride. Somebody praised me." You know? So you should quickly remind yourself of this story, that the praise of this person means nothing unless Allah praises me. And if you think about that, automatically any pride that comes in your heart will go away. Subhanallah. On hearing this incident, some pious and righteous elders sobbed and fell down unconscious. Allahu Akbar. They went into hal. They went into wajd when hearing the story, pondering how people praise them in the world while they have no convincing knowledge of what decision Allah most exalted will pass over them on the day of judgment when He sees them. Thus, it is foolishness to regard oneself as good and as pious and righteous individual in this world. We should take lesson from this girl's intelligence. Hadrat Shah Abdul Ghani, rahmatullah alayhi, used to say, when our death occurs on iman, only then can we celebrate all the actions we have done in our life. To celebrate before that and to regard oneself as great due to people's praise is foolishness. Like a person, my sheikh said, a person does an exam, and before he gets the result of the exam, he's going to people, I passed the exam. He just wrote the SATs and he's walking out of the place of the examination hall. He just wrote the exam. And he walks out of the examination hall, straight A's. Are you okay? I aced it. You aced it? You don't even know. You didn't even get the results yet. He said, I just know. I'm the man. Everybody gonna think, oh, shut up, man. Be quiet. Stop being so cocky. Stop being so proud, right? So my sheikh said that in this life, we're in an examination. Don't say that you've passed this examination. The only time we'll know if whether we pass this exam of life or not is on the day of judgment. Before that, don't say nothing. Just stay quiet and hope for the mercy of Allah. The cure for ujub. Okay, so that was pride. What about ujub? The thing where you start thinking that I'm very special. I'm special because I can give a nice lecture. I'm special because I can speak two words of Arabic. I'm special because, you know, I can read Quran very nice. I'm special because I look like a model. I'm special because I have this, that, and the other. I'm special because my muscles are really, you know, attractive, right? The cure for ujub is that one should regard every excellence and bounty as a gift from Allah Ta'ala. Right? I'm special because I have knowledge that Allah has granted me that knowledge. And whenever Allah wants to take that knowledge away, He can take that knowledge away. We have seen mashayikh that were muhaddithun. Maulana Sarfaraz Khan Sab, rahmatullah alayh, he was a teacher of Bukhari who taught Bukhari for over 50 years. He was a Shaykh al-Hadith, amazing. We saw him in the end of his life. وَمَن نُعَمِّرْهُ نُنَكِّسْهُ فِي الْخَلْقِ أَفَلَا يَعْقِلُونَ. And those that we want to give them long life, we reverse them in creation. Do they not ponder over this, those that have pride? I saw the Shaykh al-Hadith that when he would give the dars of Bukhari, on one hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, he would spend an entire month. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. This one, he would, in the explanation of this one hadith, he would spend an entire month explaining it. This is the knowledge that Allah had granted him. When we saw him in the last stage of his life, do you know what his condition was? He's just sitting there, and he would just look at you, and he would point, and he would say like this, and you would ask him a question, and he would just point to his books. He said, go to my books. And he was just like a child, like a baby. Allahu Akbar. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. It says here that regard every excellence as that if that was the excellence of the sheikh should never lose his knowledge. If the sheikh had earned that, right? That knowledge of Bukhari, then you should never lose it. If this is mine, I should never lose it. But if it's something that is given to me, like for example, Sheikh Qasim gave me this shawl as a gift, and I'm carrying it and I'm very prideful. This is my shawl. Right? This is my shawl. But Sheikh Qasim comes up to me one day and says, give me my shawl back. Hey, wait a minute, this is my shawl, man. What do you mean my shawl? Give it back to me. I'm the one that gave it to you. He takes it away from me. Like, where's my pride now? And exactly all the gifts that is granted to us by Allah Azza wa Jal, everything that's given to us, it's given to us by Allah. And Allah can take it away from us. Whether it's our children, don't ever be proud that my child is so beautiful and so handsome and I'm going to put my daughter in the, you know, children's model competition, right? Because my daughter is so attractive, and why would a person do that? I don't know. But taking pride in these type of things, Allah can take that child away from you just like Allah gave you that child. Allah can take your knowledge away from you, just like Allah has given you that knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can take your wealth away from you, just like He has given you your wealth. Allah can make you bankrupt overnight. Overnight you can become bankrupt. We know people, CEOs, that became homeless. In San Francisco, I saw a person, he's in his three-piece suit and he's begging. He said, I lost my job and I'm unemployed and I have no choice but to beg so I can eat. This is the condition that we've seen. How can a person have pride over something that he did not achieve himself? وَمَا لَكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Any ni'mah and any bounty that you have, it is from Allah. It is not from your own self. Qarun, everybody knows about Qarun. Qarun, when Musa alayhi salam said, give from what Allah, وَأَحْسِن كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Give the wealth from which Allah has given you. Do you know what he said? إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. What do you mean Allah gave me? I earned this, man. I worked hard to build my factory and my business. This is my hard-earned money. This is my business. What do you tell me? Allah gave this to me. إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. That's one interpretation. I got this from my own knowledge. عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. Yani the knowledge that I possess. That's how I got all this money. Because I'm a smart businessman. Allah didn't give this to me. أعوذ بالله. And we know what happened. From his pride, Allah caused him to get sucked into the earth. Allah caused him, al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. The scholars say, why did Allah make Qarun get swallowed up and go down? Because he was going up. Right? Allah caused Qarun to go down because he kept wanting to go up. So Allah said, I'm going to make you go down. I'm not going to make you go up. Right? So regard everything to be a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a person should continuously fear that it can be snatched away due to some evil action of ours. We don't know when we can become mahroom. Just at any moment when we start thinking that we're proud, Allah can take away our wealth, Allah can take away our beauty, Allah can take away our intellect, Allah can take away our knowledge, our children, our wife, our marriage. Everything is a gift from Allah. Don't ever think that this is from me. And if you just say, oh Allah, thank you for your blessings, Allah will increase you in the blessings. Doesn't everybody want that their blessings and their beauty and their money and their religion should be safe? Everybody wants that, right? So this is the technique. This is what our Shaykh taught us. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are thankful to me and you attribute all your blessings to me, I will increase you. وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ. And if you are ungrateful and you think that you're the one that earned it, then know that my punishment is very severe. I'll take it away from you, just like I gave it to you. Allah just wants us to recognize where that bounty came from. One should always fear Allah's independence and quality of being samad, self-sufficient. The pious and righteous elders have stated, continue doing good deeds, at the same time continue to fear. Karte raho or darte raho? Karte raho, darte raho. Continue to do good deeds, and at the same time continue to fear that they might not be accepted, but have hope that Allah Ta'ala will accept them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the understanding. May Allah purify us from all the evil characteristics and adorn us with all the good characteristics. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. So there's much more, and we just get a teaser or a taste test, right? And a sample of what this book is about, inshallah. You'll find all the explanation and the symptoms of the various diseases of the heart and the cure to those diseases of the heart. Inshallah, may Allah Ta'ala make this book beneficial and make it a sadaqa jariya for my Shaykh, rahimahullahu ta'ala, wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Assalamu alaikum again. Man, that's some good stuff, mashallah, mashallah. We're now going to open up our Q&A session. If Shaykh Qasim would come join us up here. We have some questions, and I'd just like to introduce Shaykh Qasim just a little bit for those of you who don't know. He moved here from Iowa. His family moved him to Washington, ended up going to UW, was part of the Rose Bowl team as a nose tackle. If anybody knows anything about football, that's kind of a big deal. Anyway, he had NFL interests, turned those down, ended up going to Yemen, studying over there, mashallah. And now he's doing a lot of things in the community, as I've mentioned before, the Mihrab Institute, having scholastic people come, teaching classes, doing youth organizations, all sorts of things like that. We're just happy to have him. mashallah. He has aqidah in fiqh, nuhu, tajweed, and dawah. Mashallah, he's the Amir and the executive director and the resident scholar of Mehrab. And without further ado, I'll let them take your questions right here. They have some that they'll be reading, inshallah.
Take this one. Give me one of those. Can you take it out?
The whole thing?
Yeah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد أشرف الأنبياء وسيدنا المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين جزاكم الله خير بارك الله فيكم. First of all, I'd like to thank Sheikh Tamim Ahmadi for honoring our event and program for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by His grace and mercy. We are so grateful and thankful to have the Sheikh bless us with his knowledge and his experience, his khidmah, his time with the shuyukh, mashallah, and just his suhbah, I think, over anything, just his company, which is, mashallah, has been extremely beneficial. I'd like to also thank all the organizers who've put on this event and program, have worked hard, inshallah, to do so. And then, inshallah, we wanted to get into a short Q&A session, up to what the Sheikh can do. We're going to do this in order, inshallah, from what we received. And to be fair, we received different questions from brothers and sisters, and we kind of jumbled them up in one big list. And we'll go from the first question that we received to the last one until the Sheikh is done answering questions, inshallah. So the first question, inshallah, is, I am a recent convert from a Catholic family. While for years I have not celebrated Christmas in a religious way, always accept gifts from my family. You mentioned we must accept a gift if it would hurt the giver where I were to refuse. Can I still accept gifts from my grandmother to keep her happy?
In regards to accepting gifts for the sake of making somebody happy, this example that was mentioned in Reformation of the Character, this example that was mentioned was specifically mentioning where that gift would be a permissible gift to accept. And our mashayikh have taught us that in the matter of the hukum of Allah and in the matter of issues where the command of Allah is becoming broken, where, for example, a person's telling you, you know, a person gives you a gift of alcohol, right? And a lot of people, they give champagne or alcohol as a gift for Christmas. Now for a Muslim, right, a Muslim should say that, you know, being straightforward about it, people can generally respect that and say that, look, I'm a Muslim, and this is something that, you know, we don't celebrate. But when we're talking about, in this example in Reformation of Character, that in the matter of the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person should not worry about breaking the heart of someone. This is not in that situation. And breaking the heart of someone is something it's very balanced, and a person should ask from shuyukh, and you should do it in a very hikmah manner and say it in a very wise way as much as possible. But this is such a sensitive issue that وَلَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. One of the qualities of the believers is that they don't fear the blame of those who blame them. And why would this be mentioned as one of the sifat of the believers? Why would that be considered as one of the sifat and qualities of the believers? That with faith, there will be coming malamat and blame upon you. When a person, right, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions this in the Quran. وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. لَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. They don't fear the blame of blamers or the criticism of those who criticize, because there will be places and times in your life that, you know, your faith will be challenged and you will be expected to conform, and there's certain times that you just have to say no. But the way that you do it, I think that's where the question lies, right? When a gift is mubah, when a gift is permissible, when a gift is halal, and you have your izzah and say, no, I'm not going to accept it because I'm going to look lowly. That's something when the gift is halal. But when a gift is specifically haram, and it is for the celebrating of a pagan custom, Christianity is a pagan custom, and giving of gifts in that time is a pagan custom. Now, the main point here is, how does a person, what is the method? And what is the way that a person should avoid that? What is the way that a person should refuse a gift? Now that is something that a person has to find the balance. It's something extremely difficult, right? And a person should, you know, apologize and excuse themselves and, you know, ask for forgiveness that I apologize that I can't take this gift. Your gift is very beloved to me, right? But unfortunately, because of my faith, this is something that I don't, you know, I don't attest to this and I don't practice it. So I think it's not about actual accepting a gift or not, but what is the method and the way? I think that's what we should try to focus on. And it's a tough one. It's a tough one. But there is a lot of struggles when a person wants to practice their deen and their iman. A lot of times I'm faced with sisters shaking hands with me, personally. And I am put in a position that, you know, a sister will put her hand out to me, and I'm a person that I have taken like a vow, right? When I was granted the son of the hadith, we took a vow. We're not gonna, you know, usikum wa nafsi bitaqwa Allah fi sirri wal alam. We were told that you have to, you know, resort to taqwa in every condition. And many times a person will, you know, I'll be in a situation where a sister will come, and I said, I put my hand on my heart and I say, sister, you are very respected to me. I'm sorry that I cannot shake your hand, because in my culture, in Islamic culture, to shake hands is disrespectful for the female. So I really apologize. I would really like that, you know, you, the khalifa of my handshaking is my wife. You can shake my wife's hand. And then they laugh it off and it becomes a normal thing, but it is very hard. It is. I've gone through that. And with our faith and with our deen and with our iman, there is something that we have to understand and accept, that we are going to go through malama. We are going to go through blame. People will criticize us for what we believe in. People will look down upon us for some of the things that we believe in. But in actuality, we're living in a country that this is something which is, it shouldn't be difficult. This is my faith, and I feel uncomfortable to do that. That itself, people are very open-minded about that. That I'm sorry, this is my faith, and I can't do this. And, you know, a person might be hurt, but you can make it up to them with other respect and honor that you give to that person. So I think that's the balance that a person has to draw. Allah make it easy.
Jazakallah, Sheikh, and thank you so much for that answer. Alhamdulillah, we're going to answer it. We're going to ask the next question, inshallah. The Sheikh mentioned the importance of softness in our character. What can you do or even advise to someone who does not have this? You know, due to a lack of their upbringing, what are some practical, spiritual, emotional work that they can do?
First and foremost, to attain softness and to attain, you know, that kindness in your temperament, and you're a very harsh person or you're a hard person, the best way to inculcate a character is, as Imam Al-Ghazali mentions in the Ihya Ulumuddin, he says, first of all, look at the rewards of that. That if a person is going to be kind and soft, what's the reward that that person is going to be getting from Allah? And also look at the harms, that if a person is not soft and kind to others, what will be the harms of that? And if we look at it, the Prophet ﷺ said that the one who has kindness and softness, Allah loves that person. And Allah is kind towards that person. Ar-Rahimun, Yarhamahum Ar-Rahman. The merciful ones, Allah shows them mercy. The one who is kind, Allah is kind to them. And the one who wants to be harsh, then Allah will show him harshness. What goes around comes around. Right? So this is one way to realize it. Secondly, right, realize this, that do unto others that you would want others to do unto you. How does, when someone's harsh to you, how do you feel? Do unto others as you would want others to do unto you. I know people that are 40, 50 years old right now. At age, they're in their 50s. And they don't want to ever go to a masjid ever again. Do you know why? Because said, when I was 5 years old, there was a guy that was harsh with me. Hey, get out of here. Why are you in the first saf? Go in the back. Don't you know that the front saf is for the adults? Go to the push. Get out of here. Now, that person from that age of 5 or 6 or 7, that harshness has made that child at the till the age of, because the child is father to the man. The child is father to the man. That child, whatever experience he experiences, That is what's going to make him when he's a man. Now you got a 50-year-old man, he hates everybody with a beard. He hates imams. He hates people of a masjid. Because when he was 5 years old, there was a man that was harsh with him. This is natural human disposition. Nobody likes that people should be harsh with me. So if you don't like people to be harsh with you, you shouldn't be harsh with people. And you should understand that مَنْ يُحْرَمُ الرِّفْقِ فَقُدْ يُحْرَمُ الْخَيْرُ كُلُّ. Anyone who is deprived of softness, he's deprived of all good. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُعْطِي مَعَ الرِّفْقِ مَا لَا يُعْطِي مَعَ الْعُنْفِ. Allah will give with kindness and softness what He does not give with harshness. There's a lot of people, they want to teach the Islam, and they want to teach the deen, and they want to teach the Quran with harshness, with the iron fist. Look at what the Prophet said. Allah will not give with harshness what He gives with softness. You will attain something ajeeb with softness. By being soft, by being merciful, by being kind. I want to share with you all how I came to deen, how I came to Islam. We weren't raised in an Islamic environment. Our family was not a practicing family. We used to do the 9 yards in my house. Christmas, Halloween, Easter Bunny, the whole 9 yards. Till I reached high school. But there was a woman in my life, my grandmother, my Jadda, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala. My grandmother, my Bibi, she was the most wonderful woman, and she's the most wonderful woman now. I had no exposure to Islam. This is pre-September 11th. I had no exposure to Islam. My only exposure, my mother didn't know anything. We used to do Christmas, they didn't care. We used to bring a tree inside the house, they didn't care. We used to give gifts and get gifts and Halloween and jack-o'-lantern, the whole 9 yards. We used to do everything. We weren't, practicing Islam. We weren't. But there was one person in my life, my grandmother, Mother Kalanam. May Allah bless her. May Allah give her a long life with afia. Everybody say ameen. Amen. She's the person why I'm sitting in front of you today. A woman who has not seen, has not been educated past second, third grade. She doesn't have more than a second, third grade education. She's the most intelligent person I've ever seen in my life. She solves problems like this, family issues, like this. One statement she says and the matter is solved. Like, oh, subhanAllah, how come I didn't think of that? How come we didn't think of that? Our uncles and aunts, and we're all masters and PhD, and one is a scholar, and another studied here and there, and we're going to her to solve our problems. Who has not even seen school, hardly. But I want to tell you what really attracted me to Islam and what kept me on this path. My grandmother, she's a tahajjud, she's a mutahajjida. Yani I never remember her missing tahajjud, let alone 5 daily prayers. She would not miss her tahajjud prayers. This is who my grandmother was. And do you know what? She was always kind to me. She was always loving to me. She used to say to everybody when my uncles would yell at me, or my grandfather, don't say anything to my grandson. That's my grandson. Leave him from me. I'll take care of him. And then I used to, mess around and do some things. And, my uncles, Choba Mekashidan, they would pull out the stick and, they would try to Afghan style, Danda ki saath. They would give me the asa, right? They would try to, rectify me through different ways. My grandmother said, stop. Don't you dare lift that stick against my grandson. That's my grandson. I'll take care of him. She would just give me a hug. This is not a good thing you did. I'm such an idiot. When my uncle would take out a stick, khub kadam. Good, I did it. Yeah, what are you going to do? And I'm trying to hide behind the, I was like, I became more stubborn. And then my grandmother, hafidhahullah, when she would say, come to me, come over here, give me a hug. And she would give me a hug. I said, that's not good what you did, isn't it? It's not good what you did. I mean, man, what a lousy person I am. How could I do something like that? Right? My grandmother, she's displeased with me. This is what I gained through the mercy, kindness, compassion of that woman. If that woman, and she was 5 times, she never told me a single day, why don't you pray? She never told me a single day, why don't you pray tahajjud? She never ever told me a single day. But all she did was show me love and kindness. And eventually I took her path. Because the image of Islam to me, the image of prayer, the image of hijab, was always that kind woman that would show me nothing but love and mercy. That was my image of Islam. That was my image. She was the representative of Islam to me. To me, Islam was always love and mercy. Prayer was always good because my grandma did it. And my grandma was the nicest woman in the world. I never prayed, but I knew prayer is good. Why? Because a good person does it. Prayer is good. Why? Because my grandma does it. She's the nicest woman in the world. But if you become harsh, prayer is bad. All these people who pray, they're bad. Why? Because that, you know, taxi driver, I saw him praying. He ripped me off. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. It just takes one guy, one bad apple, and it'll ruin everything for everybody. It takes one mullah to give a smacking to somebody, right? And he says, I don't want to read Quran anymore. I hate the Quran. A'udhu billahi min dhalik. A'udhu billahi min dhalik. I hate this. Because, you know, this mullah, he always hit me. I don't want to come to the masjid anymore because I remember getting beats. And, you know, we used to get sweets and other people used to get beats. We need to change the way teaching we teach. Right? We need to change the way that we portray Islam. Every one of us is a representative of Islam. If we want to represent Islam, we are the face of Islam, whether you like it or don't like it. If you're going to be harsh, that's how people are going to see Islam, harsh. If you want to be merciful, that's exactly how people are going to see it. So I hope that helps. What goes around comes around. My story should be a perfect example for all fathers and mothers. With my kids, yes, I studied Islam, but the way that I treat, you know, when I'm teaching, I teach my son Quran. I'm his Quran teacher. I see my son, sometimes he's reading and he goes like this. I said, Monda Shiri Bachim, are you tired? He said, yeah. I said, okay, let's close it. Let's go play for a while. I go take my son and I go play with him for a little bit. I don't want him, that the Quran should be tiredness and force and pressure and stress. Okay, let's go play. I take him to go play. And he comes back fresh. We start reading again. Sometimes I take him for Jummah. And when I take him for Jummah, I definitely go and get him some ice cream as well. Now in his mind, he's attributing Salatul Jummah with ice cream. Kids don't know. Okay, get up. Come on, let's go. How come you're not dressed? You have to go to Jummah. You're a Muslim. You have to go to Jummah. You know that? Okay. I'll take your word for it, I guess. Okay, we're Muslims, so we have to go to Jummah. That's why we have to go to Jummah. I tell you, Biya Bachim, we're going for Jummah. Oh, I don't want to go. We'll get some ice cream after. Okay. I didn't need to tell him any Quran or Hadith. I just tell you, after Jummah, I take you for ice cream. Now his brain, he's a kid. He doesn't know anything but toys and games and ice cream. Now he's attributing Jummah with ice cream. That remains a memory to him. And it starts becoming nostalgic. And it starts creating an image in his mind. It creates this image. Jummah was ice cream day. I love Jummah. I'm going to get ready to go to Jummah today. And he's an adult. He's a 50-year-old man now. He's age 50. And he's going to be like, never going to be missing Jummah in his life because he had a compassionate father. Wallahi, this is so important. Wallahi al-Azim. Brothers and sisters, don't ruin your children. Don't make your children run away from Islam. I've seen this. Nobody told me pray. Nobody. I chose it. This because of my grandmother. Because of her softness and kindness. And if we do that, understand that you will become a gateway and a doorway for other people entering into this deen. And if you are harsh, be very, very aware. You will become a blockage and an obstacle for people coming into deen. I hope that helps, inshallah.
The next question is, how can I purify my heart and still be able to live in this material world and be part of this community, part of the community? Reality, I can read, our Muslim community is also guilty of diseases of the heart. In reality, the Muslim community is also has diseases of the heart. I want tangible things I need to do to purify my heart. And then especially with the peer pressure, society pressure, cultural pressure in this time and age. It can be so intense. So what's the practical advice I can do?
Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we talk about purification of the nas, we're thinking that we have to become angels. We're always going to become imperfect. We're always going to be having deficiencies. Right? كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّاءٌ. Every son of Adam is a mistake maker. And the best of those who make mistakes are the ones who make tawbah. The ones who are constantly turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first and foremost, when we're talking about tazkiyah, reformation of the character, it doesn't mean that you're not going to have family problems. It doesn't mean that you're not going to get angry. It doesn't mean that, you know, you're not going to lose your temper. That's not what it means. Allah does not want us to become angels. Remember that. It's not going to mean that we don't have, we're not going to have love of money. Subhanallah. But the love of Allah should be more than the love of money. You can love money. There's nothing wrong with that. You can love your children. You can love your wealth. You can love your house. You can love your wife. Loving your wife is part of taqwa. Oh, he doesn't have love of Allah because he loves his wife so much. Is that taqwa? No. The Prophet ﷺ loved his wives. Right? وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ The Prophet ﷺ, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, spend time with your wives in goodness and love and mercy. Enjoy your time with them. But when the Prophet ﷺ, when Aisha radiallahu anha was asked, listen to them. This is the balance. When you asked, how can we strike that balance in our character? That was in the bayan of tazkiyah. How do we attain tazkiyah? Through the Prophet ﷺ. So how do we strike that balance in an environment? I'll give you one hadith as an example. One hadith. They asked Aisha that, oh Aisha, radiallahu anha, how is the Prophet at home? Because he's the most tazkiyah person. This is a person who's, right, higher than the maqam of the angels. Sayyidina Rasulullah, he was higher than the angels. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So, the point being is how was this person? Because he's the most perfect individual. So what was his level of tazkiyah? So Aisha said, كان يعمل في بيته وكان بساما ضحاكا. He was smiling and he was always laughing with us. And he used to help us with the chores in the house. You see, this is how you should deal with the people. And then when the time of prayer would come, is as if we didn't know him and he didn't know us. Gone. Gone like the wind. When he would be in the house with us, كَانَ ضَحَّاكًا بَسَّامًا يَعْمَلُ فِي بَيْتِهِ He was smiling and happy and joking with us. And he would help us in the house. The chores. Sayyidul Rasul. Sayyidul Anbiya'i wal Mursaleen. The master of all the prophets and messengers. He used to come and help his wives at home. Yes. And he used to laugh and smile. He didn't used to come. Bring my food. The mushrikeen were giving me a hard time. Don't you dare talk to me. I'm tired today. Dawah all day. Don't you dare talk to me, woman. Make my food, woman. SubhanAllah. Sayyidul Anbiya'i wal Mursaleen. He would come. He would smile and he would laugh. And he would start helping with the chores at the house. But then as soon as Salat time would come, he would get up and he would be gone like the wind. Like he didn't know us and we didn't know him. That is the balance. Treat people and deal with people with love and compassion and mercy. But when it comes to the hukum of Allah, deal with the hukum of Allah and fulfill the commandments of Allah to the best of your ability. And another very important thing, sit in the company and the suhbah of the mashayikh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you such great people. Maulana Faisal is here. Sheikh Qasim is here. Take benefit from their company. Sit with them. Not like you sit with a buddy. Sit with them to gain reformation of the heart. Loving your money, loving your wealth, loving your family is not against the love of Allah. The love of Allah should be more. Like my Sheikh used to say, the love of wife can be shadeed, but the love of Allah must be ashad. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّا لِلَّهِ So your love for your wife can be shadeed, but the love of Allah should be ashad. Shadeed means you love them, you spend time with them, but when the hukum of Allah comes, when Salatul Maghrib comes, you're not going to miss it because I'm sitting at my house talking to my wife. I'm enjoying it so much. Ah, forget Maghrib. I'm not going to pray. She's so beautiful. I just want to sit and just stare at her all day. Oh, Zalim, now the love for your wife has become more than the love for prayer. Look at the Prophet. He was loving his wives. He was spending time with them, quality time. But then when the time of prayer came, Allah became more beloved to him than anything else. You can love your wealth. You can love your wealth. Hold on to it. Like Mufti Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi said, he said, the wealth can be in your money, in your hand. Let the dollar be in your hand. Let the dollar be in your pocket, but don't let the dollar be in your heart. You can have the dollar in your hand, no problem. Have the dollar in your pocket, no problem. Have the dollar in your account, no problem, but don't have it in your heart. Don't have it in your heart. When the time of zakat comes, oh, maqa zakat dadimke. I've given so much zakat. There was a Syria you know, fundraiser. I gave my money. Now I don't need to give my zakat. I gave my charity. Some people, you talk to them. This is what they say. Brother, it's time to go for Hajj now. Oh, what are you talking about, Hajj? I gave money at that charity foundation. I don't need to go for Hajj. There's so many poor people dying in the world. Why should I go for Hajj? Where did you come up with this? Now, when because it's your money. Your money is beloved. So when you're having your daughter's wedding, $50,000 wedding, why are you spending money in that? You have a $50,000 wedding for your daughter, right? Giving $10,000 to the belly dancer, $10,000 to the hotel, $5,000 to the limousine, $5,000 to the singer. And you don't want to give $5,000 to go for Hajj? Then you remember the poor people? Why don't you remember the poor people when it's your daughter's wedding? It's very intriguing, right? Very amazing. Because your love for that is more than your love for Allah. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. That the lovers of Allah, their love for Allah is more intense, but that does not mean that they don't love anything else. So it's a balance. And how we strike that balance? Reading the life of Rasulullah ﷺ. Connecting ourselves with the mashayikh and sitting in good company. May Allah give us the ability to do that, inshallah.
Bismillah then. Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. The next question is from a sister. Please discuss women seeking out a Shaykh, bay'ah, etc. in the context of the United States. Other opinions than taking the Shaykh of her husband, as this is not possible for many women. And then combining that with another question, what are the qualities to look for in a Shaykh? How frequently do we need to keep in contact with the Sheikh?
As far as bay'ah is concerned, we hear a lot about having bay'ah to a Sheikh. And the person that we've heard his name over and over again, numerous times, Hakim al-Ummah, Sheikh Ashraf Ali Thanwi, rahimahullah, he mentions that tazkiyah is necessary. Purification is necessary. But bay'ah to a sheikh is not necessary. A person can take benefit from someone. I'm sitting with Sheikh Qasim, I'm benefiting from him. I'm not bay'ah to him, I'm another sheikh. I'm bay'ah to my sheikh who passed away, rahmatullahi alayhi, and then to his khadim after Mir Sab, damat barakatuhum, his khas khadim. I have been connected with him now. But he's not my sheikh, he's my friend and he's my companion, he's my colleague. And I am benefiting from him, he is benefiting from me. Actually, Imam al-Ghazali mentions that there's four ways that a person can attain tazkiyah. One in the most important way is for a person to have a sheikh. Right. And he says, قَلَّمَا يُوجَدْ فِي هَذَا الزَّمَانِ. That for having a true sheikh in this day and age is very, very difficult that a person find that. The main thing is the tazkiyah. Right? Sheikh, it might be difficult to find that in this day and age. And bay'ah, to make actually allegiance and say, oh sheikh, you know, I promise, and you make tawbah at the hands of somebody and there's like a ceremony and all that kind of stuff, this is not necessary. The scholars mentioned that this is mustahab. This is something if a person wants to do, it's okay, it's good, it helps you, you know, confine yourself, and it helps the nafs to remain binding under somebody, but it's not something which is absolutely necessary, because people leave tazkiyah because of the concept that they have to make bay'ah. Oh, I have to make bay'ah, so I'm not going to do tazkiyah anymore. No, there's no need for that, right? Bay'ah is not, there's a lot of people that are connected with me, and they ask me questions, and they are asking inquiries, and they're not bay'ah with me. I don't want people to become bay'ah with me. We don't call to ourselves. We don't encourage people to make bay'ah. What is bay'ah? Right, the most important thing is we call to Allah and Rasul. We don't call to ourselves, and we don't call for people, right, so we can have a little, you know, a clique of people around us. Bay'ah is not the objective. Tazkiyah is the objective, right? And some of the sisters are asking, how can we connect ourselves to shuyukh? You're connected to us right now. You're connected to us right now. By you coming in this gathering, by you hearing our words, by you implementing, inshallah, the teachings that you hear, you are connected to a sheikh. Also, anybody that wants, they can take Sheikh Qasim's information. Anybody who wants, they can take my information. Inshallah, I'll give you my email address. Any questions that you have about tazkiyah, you can feel free to contact me, to ask me if you have any inquiries about the spiritual path. I am ready to help you. This is connecting yourself to a sheikh. Just like you connect yourself to a mufti. A mufti, you have a question about fiqh, you have a question about any type of external matter of religion, you ask a mufti and the mufti answers you. You've connected yourself to that person. Right? So as a woman or as a male, male or female, this is the way that, and I think that those people that want that higher level, like we were people, we wanted the whole nine yards, man. We don't want just, we want everything. We wanted the whole nine yards. I was ready to do anything. But a person has to reach that maturity, reach that understanding. Don't just give yourself to anyone. Don't just give yourself to anyone. Oh, quickly make bayat. Why? This sheikh's turban looks awesome. There are signs. Hakim al-Ummah Tanwi rahimahullah mentions the most important thing about a sheikh is that he should be internally and externally in accordance with the Quran and Sunnah. That's number one. If a sheikh, his external and internal, does not conform to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's not a sheikh, he's a sheikh with a little bit of milk. Milkshake. Don't attribute yourself to that person. He's a milkshake. If a person does not conform to the sunnah, zahiran wa batinan, he is not worthy of being a sheikh. I don't know why he's calling himself a sheikh. Right? If a sheikh is telling a woman, oh woman, I need to come and see you. You have to come and visit me at my house. Because if I don't see your face and I don't know what you look like, then how am I going to intercede on your behalf on the Day of Judgment? Or you start writing to a certain sheikh and the sheikh tells you, well, I need you to send me your photos through Twitter or through Facebook. Because if I don't see your photo, then I can't make muraqabah and send you my face and my electric power that I have. I have to see the way you look like. This sheikh is not a sheikh. He's a shaytan. And a lot of people, through these type of jali peer sahibs, this is the thing that has given badnami to tasawwuf. This has given a bad name to tasawwuf. Peers that are after making money. They just want your money. If a peer is asking you money, khalas, forget that peer. Right? I'm not talking about durus and these type of things. I'm talking about, sheikh, you know, I want for every question, how many questions do we have? Imagine. For every question, I want $10 per question. What type of sheikh are you? Right? For spirituality? Our akabar used to tell us, you know, that a person who comes to you and asks you, can I get the dhikr of Allah? Can you make talqeen of dhikr? Can you tell me what du'as and what dhikr I should make? He said, okay, make bayah to me first, and then inshallah, bring me a sacrificed goat, and you know, maybe a frosted cake with a little bit of strawberry inside of the middle. Maybe, you know, some biryani. A biryani dish, and then they have the whole, you know, like the jali peeves in India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh. We have them everywhere. It's a career. It's a really good career. You write a couple of taweez, you know, say, you know, keep this, you know, hang it around your neck, and you know, you'll be protected by me. You have my gaze upon you. You have my face and my gaze, right? This type of mentality. This is unacceptable. A person who's asking you money, a person who, wallahi, one of the qualities of my sheikh, rahimahullah ta'ala, he did nothing but give us and he did not take anything from us. This is one of the purposes why we wanted to give this book in the spirit of the teachings of my sheikh, that he used to have these books and he just used to give. And we want in our spirit to give and not ask and anything in return. May Allah save us. It's difficult. But these are those fake sheikhs which you have to be very, very careful of. Don't be jumping to make bayah to somebody. You don't need to make bayah to nobody. But you definitely need to connect yourself to somebody. Understand this very, very well. And Hakim al-Ummah rahimahullah mentioned the first sign of the sheikh is what? That his complete concordance to the Quran and Sunnah. That's number one. Number two, when you sit in his company, you should feel more inclined towards the akhirah and less inclined towards dunya. When you're sitting with that sheikh and now, you know, sheikh has a, you know, $10,000 watch and sheikh is, you know, driving in a Maserati and, you know, he's having it. You're like, oh man, I'm poor. This sheikh doesn't even want to sit around me. I'm a poor person. How can I, subhanAllah, you know, there have to be a certain level of tawadu and humbleness, and to see his external condition makes you want to become more inclined towards akhirah. Not that wearing a nice watch or driving a nice car is something which is bad. It's not bad. Something good. But his condition should make you become more desirous of the hereafter and less attached to the dunya. Somebody came to Haji Imdadullah and he complained. He said, Haji Saab, he said, everybody that comes in your company, you mess them up. They don't want to do anything else. He said, that's what we do. We mess people up. What can I do? That's my job. People come in my company, they don't want to be in dunya no more. What am I supposed to do? I'm not telling people to leave the dunya. When you take the dhikr of Allah, when you sit in the company of the people of Allah, all you're thinking about now when you go home is like, how can I please my Allah? Man, I wish I could take some time off from work and I could spend some time in the masjid, spend some time about learning my religion. That's what happens when you sit in the company of these Ahlullah and the people of Allah. So that's another sign. And the most important sign that this is a shaykh for you is munasabah, compatibility. Do you have a compatibility with that person? Like, okay, a person might have a nice jubba, he might have a nice shawl, a nice little shiny topi with flowers on it, right? Flower power. He might have a topi and a kufi with flower power. But it's just, you don't click with that person. You just don't connect with that person. What that person says, it just doesn't settle in your heart. That's fine, right? There's various flowers in the garden. Somebody doesn't like roses, they like daisies. Some people don't like daisies, they like other types of flowers. So there's various flowers in this garden. Just pick the flower that you like. You don't have to fall in love with every flower, but you can accept that every flower is beautiful. Every flower smells good, but this is the flower for me. I like red roses. Similarly, in the garden of the mashayikh, we have roses, we have daisies, we have different types of, right? Different types. So according to your compatibility, what do you feel compatible with? Right? This is the person that you should connect yourself with. For example, you know, a person wants to get married. Connecting yourself to the shaykh is very similar to getting married. Sorry, I have to use that example. But like, you know, when you see, okay, would I marry Sheikh Qasim?
I would marry you, so.
Yeah. This is what you have to ask yourself. It's like, is this person a person of good character? And remember, marriage, we always think about marriage from a sexual perspective or for a lust perspective, not from a character. Can I live with this person? What is the character of this person? Can I tolerate this person? Can I be day and night with this individual? Does this person annoy me? Right? Like a woman could be the most beautiful woman in the world and you don't get along with her. Why is that? She's very beautiful. How come you don't get along? It's the compatibility. It's not her beauty. Similarly, when you're looking at a shaykh, don't look at the size of the guy's turban. Don't look at the length of his jubbah. Don't look at the length of his beard. His beard is all the way down to his navel. So mashallah, the longer the beard, the pious the individual. You don't judge a person by the length of his beard. Right? What do? You have to see, does this person conform to the Sharia? And am I connected with this person? What he's saying, does it make sense to me? Is this guiding me? Is this benefiting me? So this is, I mean, it's a long discussion, but in a nutshell, these are the main things. And the brothers and sisters, anybody, consider tazkiyah to be an important aspect of your life. Connect your shaykh, connect yourself to a shaykh of tazkiyah who's qualified in that. Sheikh Qasim is a perfect example. Sheikh Faisal is an example of that as well. And anybody that you feel comfortable with, if anybody would like to ask me or have any inquiries, you can take my email address and any questions you have specifically about tazkiyah, specifically about the diseases of the heart or how to rectify and better yourself. In this day and age, the suhbat and connecting yourself is the most beneficial, important thing. May Allah give us understanding.
JazakAllah khair.
Sure? Yeah.
The next question is, JazakAllah khair, Shaykhana. If you know or think someone has kibr, you ignore him or her, and you choose not to be around that person, do you also have kibr in doing so?
If a person has a very contagious disease, and you go away from that person, right? Because that person has a very extremely contagious disease and he's on quarantine. Do you have kibr when you go away from that person? Do you? That's not kibr. You're trying to save your life. There's a dog that has rabies. You're running away from the dog. Do you have kibr? You should run away from people with evil qualities and from bad company just as you run away from a dog with rabies. Run away from evil company. You know that these people drink. You know these people smoke weed. You know these people have a lot of negative things. Run away from them like you run away from a dog with rabies. And when you do that, you're not despising that person, right? You look down upon the sin, not the sinner. But you have to realize that when you're going to be sitting in the company of such people, their condition is going to affect your heart. So do not feel bad of going away from the company of somebody who you feel that person's influence will be negative upon your soul. Don't feel bad about that. Say salam to the person. Fulfill the haqq of that person. Assalamu alaikum, brother. How are you? Wa alaikum assalam. Show the person the respect that he deserves as a Muslim, as a human being. But you don't need to sit around that person all the time. That's the main thing too, you have to understand.
The next question is, how does one attain humbleness in a marital relationship? What can a husband do to not be a bully? What can a wife do to not be a bully? Their relationships in the home are creating negative, bully, prideful children in the home.
Very simple. In a marriage, I just apply the golden rule. You know what's the golden rule? Do unto others as you would want others to do unto you. Speak to your wife how you would want your wife to speak to you. Treat your wife how you would want your wife to treat you. It's a mutual relationship. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, wa'ashiruhunna. Treat them bil ma'roof, kindness. Treat them. He didn't say to the women, treat men with kindness. How is that? Right? Because women, in actuality, they're expected to serve their husbands. This is in every culture. Is it not? It's naturally accepted and it's naturally expected that a woman, you know, she looks after her husband, she makes food for him, you know, when he comes from work, takes care of him. She is the one in charge of the household affairs. So this is automatic, but it's not automatic that a man is going to do kindness, right? Because now he's the king of the house now. No, that's why Allah Azza wa Jal said, wa'ashiruhunna. Oh men, yes, she is somebody that's doing kindness to you. Because it's expected of her. But I expect of you that you should be kind to your wife. I am expecting of you. The society expects from women. But Allah is expecting from the men. Ashiruhunna. Allah is commanding the men. You, who is ashiru, this is the fa'il. Hum, or who, is the fa'il. Hunna, this is the maf'ul. The women, right? The men are supposed to show kindness to the women. Doesn't mean that women are not supposed to show kindness, but in our cultures, we know that women automatically are expected to be kind. So here Allah is giving the command to those who think that they're not expected to be kind. Allah is commanding. So brothers and sisters, to keep a beautiful and healthy environment in the home, treat your wife as you would want your wife to treat you. Treat your husband as you would want your husband to treat you. And you'll see that things will be dandy. And when the children are seeing the relationship between husband and wife, when the children are seeing the relationship between mother and father, they'll be like, SubhanAllah, look at this respect. Mother and father show so much respect to each other. How can we not show respect to our father? If the wife is yelling at the husband, that teaches the children that you can yell at your father. When the woman and the wife is yelling at her husband, right? She is teaching actually her children that this is how you yell at your father. When a man is beating his mother, beating his wife, I'm sorry. When a man is beating his wife or verbally abusing her, he's secretly teaching his children that this is what you should do to your mother and this is what you're going to do to your wife. There's people that are very abusive husbands. How did they become abusive? Where did they see that? They saw that in their own fathers. Their fathers were abusive. And that's how they've become abusive. Right? Because nobody learns how to be a husband. Did anybody teach you? Did anybody took a how to be a husband program before marriage? I didn't. But I did. I did take a how to be a husband. Before I got married, I went to my sheikh. I got married in Iran. We had family there. I got married in Iran. And I was going from Karachi to go get married to my wife, very excited, young man, right? I remember how excited I was, SubhanAllah. And I went to my sheikh, I said, sheikh, give me some advice. I took a crash course on how to be a husband from my sheikh. This is shuyukh or something else. He was like a father to me, my beloved sheikh, rahmatullah alayh. So I said, sheikh, how should I be a husband? So my sheikh told me, he said, treat your wife the same way you would want your son-in-law to treat your daughter. You get that? And another, he explained it again. He said, treat your wife the same way that you would want your brother-in-law to treat your sister. If anybody has a sister, does anybody have a sister here? You have sisters. How would we like somebody to go like this to our sister? Shut up, you little. To make that face and show that anger and you better get that food ready right now. You like somebody to be like that with your sister, your children, your sister, your mother? We have ghayra. So my sheikh, wallahi al-azim, till this day his words resonate in my ears. Till this day. That when I get angry at my wife or whatever, we have arguments, we have this you have disagreement, argument, whatever, it's natural. Then I want to react. I think about the advice of my sheikh. How would you want your brother-in-law to treat your sister? She's also somebody's sister. Your wife is somebody's sister, you know that? Your wife is somebody's daughter, do you know that? Wake up and realize that. And if you realize that point, you will see that your whole relationship will change. When you treat your wife as if she's somebody's daughter, and when you treat your wife as if she's somebody's sister, and when you treat your wife as if she's somebody's niece, then you'll be very careful. No, wait a minute. I don't want somebody to treat my sister like that. Raise their hand at my sister. I don't even want you to look at my sister wrong. I don't even want you to squint at my sister like this. I don't even want you to frown at her, isn't it? That's how we want somebody to treat our sister. So you should be, what goes around comes around. The golden rule. Remember the golden rule. Treat your wife how you would want to be treated. Treat your husband how you would want to be treated. Speak to her how you would want to be spoken to. We know that wives sometimes they get tired. Wives sometimes they get overwhelmed. I see my bichari wife sometimes. She has 3 children, little 2-year-old terrible twos he's in right now. And they're screaming and they're just ripping the house apart. And then, you know, I come home and the food's not ready yet. I get angry because I come home, I'm out all day and I'm hungry. And then I just, all you need to do is just look at the house. Look at the condition. Look at her wada. Look at her state of affairs. Don't get angry, you know. And many times shaitan comes in your heart at that time. And shaitan doesn't love anything more than he loves that a husband and wife should fight with each other. At that moment, I tell you, shaitan comes in my heart. What the heck is going on? I'm so hungry. You haven't prepared food yet? I'm dying here. Come on. What's going on? Get the food ready. You haven't eaten for like 6-7 hours. You get hungry. So that comes in my mind. Then all of a sudden, you know, it just comes in my mind and says, what are you doing? Right? She's also a human being. Look at what she... And wallahi, sometimes all you need to do, take care of 3 kids, 2 years old, right? 4 years old and 7 years old. This is like Royal Rumble. This is called a Royal Rumble. This is like a total like battlefield. Sometimes you just terrorize. And sometimes she leaves me. She has to go, for example, appointment. And I'm taking care of the kids for like, you know, just like about half hour. Where is she? Text message after text message. Where are you? This kid is crying. You know this one's filled his diaper like beyond the limit. Where have you been? And then I realize I'm half hour with these kids and I'm going crazy. And my wife is with them for 10, 15, 20 hours a day. What's the matter with you? Right? So just do unto others as you would want others to do unto you. Do to your family. Be with your family how you would want her to be with you. Then when she hasn't cooked food that day, I said, let me help you out. What do you need? He said, just watch the kids for a while. Let me put this, you know, let me put the food in the oven. I'm just going to, you know, make it right. And everything comes back to normal. And she appreciates you. You have to understand each other. When you have that understanding, you appreciate her. She will start appreciating you. Wallahi, that's all a woman asks for. Respected brothers, all a woman asks for is that you appreciate them and you show them love. Wallahi, you appreciate these sisters and you show them love, they will do anything for you. And never be disappreciative of them. They give a lot. Our wives and our mothers do a lot for us. Our mothers do so much for us, right? But we don't appreciate them and we don't love them. Let's change that, inshallah. And you'll see, you know, when you treat others good, you will get the good treatment as well. That's how bullying will go away with that as well. When you don't act like a bully, then, you know, people won't dislike you.
JazakAllah khair, Sheikh. This is the last question, inshallah, because we need to wrap up before the adhan. What is the difference between confidence and arrogance? Also, the difference between humility and lack of self-esteem?
Hakim al-Ummah rahimahullah, he mentions that confidence means that you can perform a job well. Confidence, it means that you can perform a job well. That's the meaning of confidence. Pride means that you look down upon somebody else. You see the difference? For example, if I consider myself more, if I consider myself more knowledgeable in something, that I have more qualification in this specific thing, right? That doesn't mean that I think that somebody else is more inferior in me in the sight of Allah. Because look, I might be knowledgeable, but this person might be very closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than me. So confidence means that I can perform this task very good. Confidence doesn't mean that I am better than this person. It's two different things. Being akmal doesn't mean that you are afdal. This is the exact wording of Hakim al-Ummah. Sheikh Qasim, does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Being akmal in a specific thing doesn't mean that you are afdal. Yani fadila wise. You understand? Considering yourself that you are, you know, good in something doesn't mean that you are better than somebody else. Better than somebody else in status. Right? That person can still have a higher status than you. Understand? I hope that makes sense, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair.
Thank you everybody for coming out. I think I want to thank all the volunteers who helped out. I want to thank all the people who donated already. I want to thank all the brothers who came up from California. I want to thank everyone for helping, listening, giving your time, your attention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be with all of you. Help us all to remember these things, to take these things in our heart, inshallah. Make dua for the Sheikh and his return travel. He will be giving a small short dars tomorrow at ICOE after Fajr, and then he'll be leaving. So make dua for him and his companions that are leaving tomorrow.
Also, just one quick, I just want to tell everybody, Jazakumullah khair, and it's a very blessed occasion to be with all of you. And I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Sheikh Qasim for making this possible. I just want to tell everybody we have another program to attend. So I don't want to seem that I gave this dars and now I'm walking away from everyone. I just want to tell everybody the Masnoon Salam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I want to give my greeting and make that dua for you. And barakallahu feekum. May Allah reward you all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and your families. And I just want to take permission from everybody that because we have that program tonight, I can take your istidhan, I can take your permission to leave because we're going to be late if we don't leave now. So with your permission, inshallah, I will see you all, inshallah, and hope that we have much more programs like this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
And for everyone else who's still here, I would like to thank mention